All right, now let's deal with the history, some of the history of the Simchat Torah. Now, the name Simchat Torah was not used, some say, until relatively a late period in time, or in what some might say is latter Judaism, or the latter Judaism. In the Talmud, the Megillot 31b, it is called the Shemini Atzeret. Now, the code of Jewish law, it states that the custom of Simchat Torah is ancient. Now, the Darke Moshe, the OC 669 and 3, it cites a responsum from R. Joseph, or Rabbi Joseph Cologne, number 26, who found a geonic responsum, a response, a Latin phrase of response, mentioning the custom of dancing on the Simchat Torah, thus dating the current practice of dancing on the Simchat Torah back to the geonic, what's known as the geonic period. Now, parenthesis here. This does not appear in our version of the Amharic. Amharic, these are all some specialized terminologies. Make a note of it, and we will hopefully get to teach on this. Just some of the history is important for us to know. Now, although there is generally a prohibition against dancing by some Jews on the Shabbat as well as on the festivals, this was evidently relaxed for the sake of the honor of the Torah. Now, in the 9th century, some European Jewish communities, and they actually have here some European Jewish communities, they assigned a special reading, a special nibab or minbab from the Nabiyat, the prophets, to be added on this day. And in the 14th century, the reading of Genesis was added immediately upon the completion of Deuteronomy. Now, in the southern European countries, it then became a general practice to remove all the Torah scrolls from the ark and to sing a separate hymn for each scroll. Now, in the northern European countries, those who had finished the reading of Deuteronomy made donations to the synagogue, after which the wealthier members of the community would give a dinner for friends as well as for acquaintances. By the end of the 15th century, it was common, though not a universal practice, for the children to tear down and burn the sukkahs on the Simchat Torah. Very interesting. In the 16th century, the practice of taking out the scrolls and filing in a solemn way around the bima, which is the reading station, the reading desk in the synagogue, on the night of the 23rd of Tishri, it became a customary and a traditional practice. And on the same evening, after the procession, a number of passages from the Torah were read. In the 17th century, Rebecca Bat Meir Tikhtiner of Prague, or Prague, she composed a poem about the Simchat Torah. Now, in Poland, and we're speaking now among the European Jews, because we're getting to know, well, what is that practice, and then we will get more into what our practice, where they are correct, where the scriptures and the Spirit of God shows us that that is correct, and where some other things are superfluous, and we allow the other ones to do that, but we will do, make our wills obedient to good influences and avoid whatever we deem and is deemed as evil according to that good influence of the King of Kings and his Christ. But in Poland, it was the custom to sell to the members of the congregation on the 23rd of Tishrei the privilege of executing various functions during the service on Shabbat and Jewish festivals. So, in other words, ones chose, well, what they wanted to do. And in Poland at this particular time, they would sell to members of the congregation these sort of privileges. Very kind of interesting but questionable. In other words, the synagogue used this occasion as a fundraiser, and people who made these donations were called up to the Torah and given a congregational bereket, or a blessing. It became a custom for every male member of the congregation, or what we know as the machaber, translated as society. The line of Judah society is a Yehuda Moa Andesa machaber, to read from the Torah, the passage from Deuteronomy chapter 33, verses 1 to 29, being repeated as many times as was necessary for this purpose. Today, this practice is still followed in many of the Orthodox synagogues. Conservative synagogues adapt this practice by also including women. One person is given the privilege of completing the reading of the law with Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 1 to 12. He receives the name of Hatan Torah, the bridegroom of the Torah. Our sages, and the Hebrew and Jewish sages, they have taught that a new beginning must immediately follow completion. So upon completion, there must be a new beginning. But we know that the root of that true idea comes from the wisdom that Moses, Moshe, Mashu, was learned in from the Egypts, or ancient Egypt, where they taught this cycle and this truth as well, which came from ancient Tob, or the Kui land, otherwise known as Ethiopia. So after one completion comes a new beginning. So after the Hatan Torah comes the member who recommences or re-begins the reading of Torah with Genesis 1. He is called the Hatana Berasit, or Berashit, as they pronounce it. We pronounce it Berasit, which is the bridegroom of Genesis, receiving the first aliyah, the first call to come up to the bima, to the reading table, and to have the honor to read from the Torah for them within the Hebrew, for us in the royal Amharic of the Metzhav Keddus of Negusa Neges, the Emperor's Bible, or the Book of the Seven Seals. So receiving this first aliyah of the Torah is thought to be propitious, is thought to be a blessing beyond any sort of measure, because that one, that Hatan Berasit, you understand, is now blessed for success in all undertakings, both spiritual as well as material or temporal. It is considered by some to be the most special aliyah, the most special being, the most special calling up, to rising up to the reading of the entire year, because the beginning and the end are the holiest times. Just as with the Sukkot, or the Sukkot, we have the beginning is a Shabbat, or an Eref, Bamarinya, and the end, or the eighth day, the Shemini Atzeret, is also a Shabbat or a Ereft. So the beginning and the end, and this is completes the cipher and continues the cipher. The last point that we would like to make about this concerns this Simchat Torah as a symbol of Jewish identity, and how we must reclaim that which we have lost as a symbol of our Black Hebrew identity, or Ethiopian Hebrew identity. Now, this all begins in the 20th century. the Simchat Torah, it came to symbolize the public assertion of Jewish identity for the OJs or the other Jews. The Jews of the Soviet Union in particular, they would celebrate the festival in mass in the streets of Moscow. On October 14, 1973, more than 100,000 Jews took part in a Simchat Torah rally in, guess where, New York City, on behalf of the refuseniks, and the Soviet Jewry, those Jews that refused to continue to be oppressed in the Soviet Union. So think about it, my brothers and sisters, that this is also our way out of Babylon as well, and overcoming this system, this captivity that we have been in for 400 plus years. Remember, Willie Lynch himself, 1712, 300 years, 300 plus 1712, 2012. The time is now. The time is now, my brothers and sisters. But first we have to study and show ourselves approved. We have to learn. And then we have to do. So dancing in the street with the Torah has become part of the holy day or the holidays ritual in various Hebrew as well as Jewish congregations in the United States of America as well. Now, in the state of Israel, in 1996, the Israeli Postal Authority, they issued a postage stamp to honor this particular holy day or this particular holiday. Now, there are certain songs which are sung, certain Jewish songs which are sung nowadays. There are a few popular songs that are generally sung. Since Simchat Torah is a celebration of Torah, songs regarding the greatness of Torah and of the Jews or the Hebrews' relationship, our relationship with Torah, are generally sung. And here's a partial list of some of the titles, in case you're interested, because we're interested. One is Ashrei Ha'am Shekahalo Torah Hashem Temima Moshe Emes V'Saraso Emes Baruchu Elokeinu She'baranu Lichvodo Yisroel Voraisa Ve'kutsha Berekahu Hadhu Ashreya Miya Shem Amalo Batora Va'af Al Pi Sheyisha Ma Maya Anavda De Kutsha Berekahu Vetahera Libenu Le Avadaka De MS. MS is the Yiddish way of saying Be Emet. Emet, we say Unet, which means truth, as Ethiopian world net means truth. Unet. Two more is Achas Sha'alti Meya Esa Hashem Asherenu Matova Chelakenu. Now, most of these titles are not really Hebrew, pure Hebrew. Most of them are Yiddishish kind of titles. That's part of what made them a little bit difficult to read. But the point is this, that for those Jews or other Jews, what is indigenous or native to their heritage and culture is that points to Torah and their liberty as Jews is what is highlighted. We, as the black Hebrews or black Jews, we have a lot of rhythms and harmonies and melodies from which to select and choose, both as Ethiopians at home or the Ethiopians and Hebrews in Ethiopia, as well as those of us in the diaspora. So often when the Torah is being returned to the Aron is the Hebrew for ark. That's what the ark is called in the Hebrew, the Aron. There's a song called the Su'u Sha'arim Ra Shechem is sung. When the Gabe, who is the one who functions the synagogue, calls up the Kohen, the song in the Yiddish Hebrew known as V'ya'azor, V'yagin, V'yoshia, you hear Yeshua within that, this is sung as well. And this is a basic summary. This has been a basic summary of the Simchat Torah, or the joy of the Torah. And for us, as Ethiopian Hebrews and Black Hebrews and Black Jews, it would be proper for us to have our Simchat Torah on the Shabbat or the Senbet, which follows the first Senbet after the assembly of the eighth day, which is known in the Hebrew as the Shemeni Atzeret. So, in other words, this season right here, today, and we're recording this a little bit earlier, so we'll have it all ready, because it sometimes takes us a moment to upload it if we don't get good connection. Now, this is the 19th. And this 19th is a Wednesday. So this is the day for the Hosha'ina Rabbah. The next day, which will be the 7th, so tomorrow, which is the 8th, will be the Shemeni Atzeret. And that would be the Thursday. But see how in divine time it comes, that for the Friday would be the proper time for the Simchat Torah. Now, if this day had been a couple of days forward, and then after Shemeni Atzeret, say, was today, then we should take the day or two in prayerful meditation, expectation, looking forward to the Friday Eve. And from that Friday Eve should be the Simchat Torah, because it begins off the year with a sabbatical reading in perfect harmony. And now, what's so interesting about this, and we're choosing to make a certain decision about the Simchat Torah, which might differ from other Jews, and even other Jews, whether they're Orthodox or whether they're conservative or whether they're Reform, so forth and so on, they even differ. Some combine the Shemeni Atzeret, which is the eighth day, with the Simchat Torah on the same day. Others have it in a more consecutive fashion and not concurrently, where they would have the Shemeni Atzeret one day, and then the next day, that would be the Simchat Torah. We are choosing to have the Shemeni on the eighth day, the Shemeni Atzeret on that day, keep the Hosha'ina Rabbah on the seventh day, and depending on what day it is that the Shemeni Atzeret falls on or occurs on, to try to have it flow into the first Shabbat of the new year after Sukkot, which would be the fall festival and the close, the end of the year. And this, as Hawari Apollos says, that this we're confident in, as we are guided too by the manifest Keddus of the King of Kings and his Christ. So brothers and sisters, Once again, Shalom Rastafari, and may you and your family in faith and of the faith of the King of Kings and our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMoshiach, Jesus Christos, otherwise known as Jesus Christ, may you have a beautifully good year, peaceful, productive, and next time for I and I, make it the African Seal. Shalom.